Good evening and welcome as we gather together in the middle of the week to come and hear God's word once again and to remember that we are not alone, but that we have a God who is with us and who comes to us. This is the first week of Advent, and so this time of preparation for Jesus to come as that tiny baby into our lives to remind us and to show us God's love. Our worship is put online every Wednesday evening at 6:15 and every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, so we hope that you will join with us as often as you can. We express our sympathies as a congregation this day, first of all, to the family of Linda Rode, who died this past Friday, and then also to the family of Carl Morkin, who died this past Sunday. So we ask that you remember those families in your prayers, that God would be their hope, and that they would be reminded of that gift and promise of eternal life. Those are our announcements for this evening, but I encourage you to think about how you can prepare for Christmas, how you can make room in your life during this season of Advent to renew again God's presence in your lives. So let us take a moment now to prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Please join with me in the greeting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. In the midst of our darkness,
shine, Jesus, shine.
Through the walls of fear and hatred,
shine, Jesus, shine.
Deep in the depths of despair and hopelessness,
shine, Jesus, shine.
We join together in this Advent prayer. We praise you, O God, for this evergreen crown that marks our days of preparation for Christ's Advent. As we light the first candle on this wreath, rouse us from sleep, that we may be ready to greet our Lord when he comes with all the saints and angels. Enlighten us with your grace, and prepare our hearts to welcome him with joy. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and whose day draws near. Amen. Let us pray. In the middle of worldwide turmoil, darkness descends and the people cry out, "Save us, Lord." Our cries have been heard, and the word which resides with God is ready to come to us. Lord, hear our pleas and enter our hearts and lives this day. Help us to be ready for the coming of Jesus. Amen.
All right, it is kids' time. So gather in this morning. I have a question for you, a few questions actually. First, do you remember from your Bibles, at the very beginning in the book of Genesis, in the Old Testament, do you remember who it said created the world and all the animals and the people? Do you remember? Do any of you kids here remember? Who created it?
God.
God. Yeah, God created the world and everything on it. Today, we're not going to hear from the book of Genesis, but we're going to hear from another book of the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah. And in Isaiah, we're going to hear about this. You ever seen this before? It's kind of a clay. Now, clay is what Isaiah talks about. And clay is a natural thing. It's a thing of the earth, something that God created. This is something that human beings created. Do you know what it is? What's it called? Play-Doh. Yeah. We had this as a kid. Kids loved it. Parents hated it, right? It would get everywhere and get into your carpet and into your hair and all that. But Play-Doh, or clay, is sculpted and molded. You can create what you want with it and make what you want with it. In Isaiah today, we hear about God being a potter. A potter is someone that makes something with clay, that molds it and shapes it into something. Now, I'm not going to attempt to make this into anything today. Clay is not my expertise or whatever. That's probably as good as I can make it. Do you know what that is?
Soft.
It's a blob. Isn't it a good-looking blob? It's a blob of nothing. That's about as good as I can get, right? But in Isaiah, we hear about Isaiah saying that God is a potter, and we are the clay. We are the Play-Doh, and we are asking God to mold us, to shape us into what God wants us to be. Now, do you have a dream or a hope for what you want to be as you grow up? If you do, say it out loud. Everyone, you here, you at home, on the count of three. Ready? One, two, Cookie Monster, three. Ah, very good. I heard a few people. Some people here are not quite sure what they want to be when they grow up. And that's okay. Maybe you're not sure either. And that's all right. But you know what your job is now? You have a job now as well. A job to be a kid, to be a student, to be a brother or sister, to be a grandchild. You have a job to be a child of God, someone that is molded by the potter, molded by God to be kind and caring, molded by God to share, molded by God to help others, molded by God to do the best that you can in all that you do. So during this season of Advent, when we have blue things around, we can be reminded that God is the potter. We are the clay. And we can pray to God to shape us, to mold us, to use us, to prepare the way, for the Lord is coming. Let us pray together. You can repeat after me. Dear God,
dear God,
you are the potter.
You are the potter.
We are the clay.
We are the clay.
Please mold us.
Please mold us.
Shape us.
Shape us.
And use us.
And use us.
To be kind.
To be kind.
To be caring.
To be caring.
And to love one another.
And to love one another.
All this we pray.
All this we pray.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Join us in singing a song.
Our first reading this evening comes from the prophet Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquity is like the wind. Take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Our gospel reading this evening comes from the book of Mark. Jesus said, "In those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch comes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day and hour no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be aware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or at cockcrow or at dawn. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace be unto you from our God and Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. On Sunday, we began the season of Advent, an important season of anticipation and longing and waiting. Just like the people in the time of Isaiah anticipated and awaited the coming of the Messiah, we now anticipate and long for and wait for our Messiah to return. It is not just about waiting to open Christmas gifts or for Christmas vacation or even just waiting to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. It is about waiting and living in the light of Christ until he returns. Our gospel for today reminds us of that. But tonight, we are going to take a look at the Isaiah text from the 64th chapter of Isaiah. Let's recap a few things that have happened before Isaiah's time. The book of Genesis, God created the world and everything on it. God created humans in his own image, and everything was good. But Adam and Eve fell into temptation, disobeyed God and sinned, and fell away from God. Time progressed and people fell farther and farther away from God. They forgot about God and they mistreated each other and others of God's creation. God was saddened and quiet. God had to fix things to clean the world. And so God asked Noah to build an ark, to to save his family and animals from the flood that God was going to send to cleanse the earth and to start over, to bring his creation back to him. God then promised to never do that again. And God's creation, God's children, promised to never go astray again. Then in the book of Exodus, God saves his children from the bonds of slavery in Egypt. And God once again frees them from slavery, from oppression, and bondage to earthly sin and evil. But while in the desert, in the wilderness, those that were just saved become sinful. They forget about God, and they start to mistreat each other. They wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. They forgot about God and thought that God had forgotten about them. The rest of the Old Testament tells us more about the history of God's people, about more times of war, of sin, and how God reacts and creates and works in love amongst and for his people and for his creation. Now with that in mind, let us again look at Isaiah 64, verses 1 through 9. And you will see where these words of Isaiah come from, what these emotions and prayers of Isaiah are based on. Verses 1 through 9. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when the fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, nor ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, whose work for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are like the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. These verses from Isaiah could just as likely be said by someone today. We are still sinful, and we still mistreat each other. We attack and hurt each other. We focus on earthly possessions and finances more than on each other and God. We focus on our own needs more than God's creation. And we sometimes wonder where God is. We wonder if God has hidden himself. How could things like environmental disasters, terrorist attacks, racial divide, illness, and greed happen? How could COVID happen? Verses 6 and 7 could have been prayed by people over the past year as they watched the daily news. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. But in verses 8 and 9 can also be said at this time. And as we enter this season of Advent, as we wait on the return of our Savior, and as we see sin and pain and destruction in God's creation all around us, I hope you also see and hear and live in these words of verses 8 and 9, in the hope that is proclaimed here. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father, and we are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. You see, there is one major difference between the people of Isaiah's time and us now. They waited for the Messiah to come, but we wait for him to return. Meaning that the Messiah, the Savior, did come and saved us all and made us all new. After the flood, God promised to never destroy the earth again. But God's children again were not listening, and they had forgotten him, and they made him sad and angry. God wanted to bring them back, and so this time, out of love, God came to earth himself to take the pain, the sin, and the suffering of the world, and to take death upon himself through his Son, Jesus Christ. The Messiah came to bring us back. Verse 6 of Isaiah 64 talks about how the people are fading, drying up like a leaf, and blowing away. But we are baptized children of God, baptized in the waters of life, baptized into the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Verse 8, we are the clay, and you are the potter, takes on new meaning in the light of Christ. Let me explain. Do you know what clay is? It is dirt that is wet. In order to mold it, to shape it, it must be wet. If it dries out, it is brittle and hard. As long as the clay is wet, it doesn't dry up, and it continuously can be shaped and used. Our Lord loves us so much that he sent his own Son to earth so that all who believe in him will be saved. All who believe in him are washed in the waters of his love, and they live in the waters of life in Christ. So they will never dry up. They will never fade away. They will live forever with him. So what does this have to do with us during this season of Advent? As we wait with anticipation for the return of Jesus Christ, as we wait for the Messiah to return to bring us all to him, the last part of verse 8 tells us what to do, what this has to do with Advent. We are all the work of your hand. We pray to God to mold us, to shape us, to change our hearts, to use us as our hands and his feet in this world now, today, to bring God's will, God's love, and God's peace to earth now. Since we are wet in the waters of baptism, since we have not dried up, God shapes and molds us each and every day. One day God might use us this way, to care for a family member. Another day God might use us to pray for someone. The next month God might shape us to someone to care for the environment. At one time in our lives, God may shape us into a student to learn and to grow. At another point, God may shape us into a teacher. At another point, a waitress or a missionary. All along, God is shaping us, using us as his hands and his feet in this world, caring for creation, bringing others back to him, and preparing for his return. Like it says in the 13th chapter of Mark, It is like man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his or her work. Sometimes we pray to God, mold me and shape me into what you want. Oh, but not that way, this way. No, I don't want to do that, or no, I don't think I can do that. But you see, clay doesn't tell the potter what to do. The potter may shape the clay into what it is meant to be, but who made the clay? In other words, who made you? God did. And God will not mold you or give you more than the two of you together can handle, or more than what you are meant to be. Have you ever heard of a young man by the name of Patrick Henry Hughes? A handful of years ago, Patrick Henry Hughes and his family were one of the families helped by the TV show Extreme Makeover Home Edition. But that's not what makes Patrick special. Patrick is truly an example of clay molded and shaped day by the potter, our Lord God. Patrick was born on March 10, 1988, and he was born with shortened arms and legs, a disproportionate truncated structure, and with no eyes. He is blind and bound to a wheelchair with a limited range of motion. Patrick has had many, many surgeries throughout his young life. Many times his parents could have prayed to God to reshape their son, to make him into some other shape like other people. And doctors could have tried to give him longer limbs, etc. But instead, God has shaped him and molded him into a talented musician, a talented, faith-filled young man who is molded each day into a vessel of God's love toward others. Patrick Henry Hughes' story is a powerful example of faith in God, the potter. I've read his story in Patrick's book, I Am Potential, 8 Lessons on Living, Loving, and Reaching Your Dreams. I want to end by sharing 2 quotes from it, 2 quotes that I hope, along with today's scriptures, will shape and mold your prayers and life during this Advent season, amongst all the earthly business of the holiday season. The first is a quote that Patrick shares from Reinhold Niebuhr, a Protestant theologian. He says, God gives us the grace to accept the serenity, the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things which could be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. The second quote is from Patrick himself. He says, I can't see, I can't walk, I can't do lots of other things. With all of this, people might think, gee, what a terrible thing. How can I bear to live like that? But I don't view it that way. Through my trials, God has given me experiences that taught me the important lessons about life, which helped me to get through each and every day. I've never felt any pressure to do more than I can, but I'm always expected to do all that I can. The greatest gift I can give back to others is to share those experiences and lessons. So in this season of Advent, let us pray together. O God of hope and love, change our hearts, mold us and shape us daily according to your will. Give us the grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things which should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. We are the clay, and you are the potter. May your work, may your love be done through our hands. Amen. Thank you.
We take a moment to consider our offering, our response to God's promises in our lives as God moves us forward in mission as a congregation. Thank you for the gifts that you share, the contributions that we join together here at Sharon Lutheran to strengthen our mission and ministry together. You can give your offering through the online website or by mailing in or dropping off your offering. And if you are a person who participates in another congregation as a member, we invite you to continue to support your home congregation. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts. With them we offer ourselves to your service, and we dedicate our lives to the care and the redemption of all that you have made, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Together we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We join together in the prayers of the people as we pray for God's world that cries out in need. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, give us diligence, especially during the season of Advent, to seek you, wisdom to perceive you, and patience to wait for you. Grant us a mind to meditate on you, eyes to behold you, ears to listen for your word, a heart to love you, and life to proclaim you. It is your will, O God, to hold both heaven and earth in a single peace. Let the design of your great love shine on our anger and our sorrows, and give peace to your church, peace among nations, peace in our homes, and peace in our hearts. O God, where hearts are fearful and constricted, grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and reassurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distress twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring wings and strengthened dreams.
God, our Creator,
through whose providing care we enjoy all goodness in life, turn our eyes to your mercy in this time of confusion, weariness, and division. Give us your comfort and patience as we continue the journey through this pandemic. Shine your light on those whose only companion is darkness. Lead us forward with confidence and hope, and show us the way to live together in peace and harmony. God, our refuge and strength, we remember before you those who are sick, especially Burnell, Ron, Debbie, Marion, Kevin, Carolyn, those suffering from COVID, and others known to you. We pray also for your comfort for the families of Linda Road and Carl Morkin as they mourn the loss of their loved ones. Be with caregivers and medical personnel whose work is endless and difficult. Strengthen them in body and spirit. Refresh them when they are weary, console them when anxious, comfort them in grief, and grant them rest and renewal. Keep watch, dear Lord, with those who work or watch or weep, and give your angels charge over those who sleep. Tend the sick, give rest to the weary, bless the dying, soothe the suffering, comfort the afflicted, shield the joyous, and all for your love's sake. All of these things we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Together as God's people, we pray the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you God's peace. Amen. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance will be revealed. Savior of the nations, come. Go in peace and serve the Lord. We will. Thanks be to God.